Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Songwriter says, when I think of all of God's goodness and all he has done for me, then my soul cries out, hallelujah. Praise God for saving me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know my song. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Matter of fact, I feel a little, don't get me started. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It is a good thing to be back into the house of the Lord. So glad you guys showed up this morning. They talking about a lot of snow coming in later on this evening, but as long as I get my shout in, I'll be all right. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just let me get my praise on. I'll be okay. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. We started out talking to you on last week about words in angels. If you wasn't here, I suggest you go back and get the CD. Words in angels. I don't know whether you realize it or not, but angels are real. They are here with us this morning. Thank you, Lord Jesus. They are in the building. They're going to help me preach. Praise the Lord. They're not going to preach, but they're going to help me preach. Thank you, Lord Jesus. From Genesis to Revelation, Scripture talks about angels. From Genesis to Revelation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. And each and every last one of us have a personal guardian angel. So I know they're in the building because, you know, you brought yours and I brought mine, so they're here. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. But I remember, you know, and this is almost kind of how I came about this message here. I remember asking the Lord, more specifically, the angels, because I was thinking along that line about the angelic host and what are angels doing right now, this very moment. What are the angels doing? Do you think they're sitting around twiddling their thumbs, singing Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, How I Wonder What You Are? Thank you, Lord Jesus. No, they are on assignment. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Angels are real and they are on assignment. They're the host of heaven. They're in stealth mode because we don't see them, and a lot of times we don't recognize that they're there, but they are there. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And I asked him, I said, well, what is it that we can do to help you guys out? And it tickled me. The thought that immediately came to mind was words. Words. Tell the children of the Most High God that they can help us out by speaking the right words. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We don't think very much of words. Amen. But the angel told Daniel when he had showed up, 21 days after Daniel had prayed, he said, Daniel, from the very first day that you prayed, I was sent. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 20 days. So I have come because of your words. I have come because of your words. We don't think very much of our words, but our words are either commissioning the angels. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I have another thought completely, but I want to give you the end, the tail end of that on words and angels. But I have another thought because I can't talk about words and angels without talking about thoughts and demons. Just as sure as words empower angels, the wrong thoughts empower demons. It's going to get interesting. Again, this is probably a study that probably should be more suitable for a Bible study tonight because we get a little in depth and in detail. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But I'm sure you're big enough to handle it. Amen? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Are you ready for it? Tell you what, let's go back and let's pick up on the 10 things that angels wish that believers knew, and then we'll go immediately into talking about thoughts and demons. 10 things that angels wish that believers knew, because I really didn't finish out this list. Number one, they wish that you knew that their primary assignment is to work for mankind. Over in Hebrews, it said that they were sent to minister to those who shall be heirs of salvation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So their primary goal and assignment is to aid and help mankind. Number two, they wish that we can help them with their assignment. They wish that we knew that we can help them in their assignment. You say, how is that? Speaking the right words. Speaking the right words. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Number three, listen, they're always present. Whether you realize it or not, they're always present. You're never alone. I'm reminded of the prophet Elisha, when those three kings had surrounded him, and his servant had come unglued when he saw how many there was that had surrounded him. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And he come running to his servant, "Master, what are we going to do? We're surrounded." And the prophet came out and looked and said, "Oh, don't worry about it. They that are with us are more than they that are with them." I love that. They that are with us. Who are they that are with us? Have you ever thought about that? Who are they that are with us? And I'm not talking about you guys. Amen. He was talking about the angels. They that are with us are more than they that are with them. And then he prayed, "Lord, open his eyes and let him see." God opened the young servant's eyes, and he saw the host of heaven surrounding all of the ones that's supposed to be surrounding the prophet. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. And again, note that just because God opened his eyes doesn't mean that that's when the angels appeared. They were already there. So I'm here to tell you, whether you realize it or not, they're already present. And if we can get this thought in mind and understand that they that are with us are more than they that are with them. The angels wish that you knew that they're present all the time. Sometimes they'll even let you feel their presence. And some of you have. You know what I'm talking about. You're alone, a little bit worried, and all of a sudden you know that presence came in and it seemed to calm you down. Come on, they that are with us are more than they that are with them. Thank you, Lord Jesus. They also wish we knew that their greatest obstacle, and here's the big one right here, their greatest obstacle was, listen to this, was getting around human will. Their greatest obstacle. Now keep that one in mind, because when we get to talking about the thoughts and the demons, I'm going to show you this. Their greatest obstacle is getting around human will. They can't make you do anything. God won't make you do anything, and the devil can't make you do anything. But the devil deceives people into yielding their will to the wrong thing. And this hinders the angels. Because no matter how much they try to influence you and motivate you to do the right things, the devil is going to be there to try to deter you and get you to do the wrong things. And whatever you will to do, they'll have to step back and just let you do it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, we've heard of these supernatural cases. Listen to me now. We've heard of these supernatural cases and miraculous cases where angels stepped in and miraculously saved somebody. Have you ever heard of or seen, these stories where some vehicle or something crashed and it was laid on somebody, and a little old woman or something reached down and picked the vehicle up? You think that woman did that on her own? No, sir. That was angelic intervention. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There are many times, you know, when I know I should have been either severely hurt or dead in a crash. Can anybody attest to that? But it was angelic intervention. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And we see these cases all the time. I was looking at a video on Facebook of this plane that was flying, and it lost a wing. It lost a wing, got out of control, and the guy landed that plane with one wing. One wing. And I immediately said, "Thank God for the angels." I remember seeing another video on Facebook where this little boy and his mother was walking, and some of you may have saw this, and a car out of control came and ran over both of them. Ran over his mother, ran over the little boy, ran over his back, his neck. And the little boy got up to run and see what was wrong with his mother. And you see the video again and again. It completely ran over the little boy. Completely ran over his back, ran over his neck. And he got up and completely went to, his mother was hurt, but he wasn't. How do you explain that? Well, I said that to say this. Notice this. That you know, now, why do they do these things on certain occasions, but not always? Because we've heard of people that have gotten ran over and died. We've heard of people that cars and stuff have fallen on and smashed them to death. Why aren't they doing this always? Human will. It's hard for them to get around human will. But every now and then, when they get somebody to agree with them and speak the right words and do the right thing, they can divinely intervene. Thank you, Lord Jesus. They also wish we knew that our words, wait a minute, They also wish we knew, listen to this, that getting around human will takes time. Notice that it took the angel 21 days to get to Daniel. See, sometimes we don't realize, and we need to know this, that God has our blessing. It's already in the process of being manifested. It's in the process. But angels, the reason why it's not an instant manifestation is they got to get around human will. And sometimes, well, on many occasions, that takes time. Well, what are we going to do while he's trying to get around human will? Hold fast to the confession. See, words. Hold fast to the confession of your faith. Words. Okay? They also want us to know that words filled with faith empowers them. When you're constantly speaking the word of faith, there's a real good chance you're going to get your manifestation much quicker. They also want, number 7, they also wanted us to know that they are constantly on the move when we live a constant life of faith. When your faith is out there, the angels are constantly moving, maneuvering, moving upon, influencing different people, places, and things to cause favor to come to you to get what you're praying for or what you're believing for or what you're standing in faith for. Number 8, they are most effective when, this was a big one. They're most effective when there's when we're, listen to this, speaking in their language, that is tongues. I don't know if you ever heard that before, but you're hearing it now. The angels are most effective when you're praying in the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You speak in their language. Somebody said, really? Yeah. The Apostle Paul said over in 1 Corinthians 13, do I speak with the tongues of men and of angels? Wait a minute. When did Paul learn how to speak angelic? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Your prayer language or your heavenly language is the same language that angels speak. And I'm well convinced that if Daniel had been able to speak in other tongues, it wouldn't have took him 21 days to get an answer. See? Words. Whether they're being spoke in your normal dialect or in angelic dialect, it empowers angels. Words empowers angels. Be careful that you speak the right words. Number 9, from time to time they will appear and speak to us as the Lord wills. Only time in eternity is going to tell you how many times you had a conversation with an angel and you didn't know it. You thought it was somebody else. How many, just by show of hands, how many out in here really believe that you have had an encounter with an angel? Yeah? You knew there was something strange about that person. I don't know what it is, but it was something about them. Yeah, I've had encounters. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Number 10, they cannot preach. If an angel appears to you and calls himself giving you some type of revelation or preaching to you, no, don't receive it. Angels are not sent to preach. Men are. Jesus said to his church, go ye into all the world and do what? Preach the gospel to every creature. Okay. Now, that's just to catch you up and to finish out that thought on words and angels. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and Ephesians chapter 6. The reason why we're going to take a little time to talk about the devil and demons is because they're fallen angels. See, we're still talking about angels and we're still talking about words, but we're going to approach it from this subject, thoughts in demons. Thoughts in demons. Oh my goodness. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning with the 4th verse, says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Listen to this. Casting down imaginations. That's your thought processes. In every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And bringing into captivity every thought. Every thought to the obedience of Christ. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Our weapon is not with you, with a regular human being. See? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. That is, your struggle is not with me. Your struggle is not with your mother-in-law. Your struggle is not with Junebug and Little Willie. Your struggle is not with anybody, not that boss lady from hell on your job. Come on. Come on. Your struggle is not with flesh and blood. I don't care how much folk act like they hate you. They're not your enemy. I don't care how much, you know, they're talking about you, you know, and trying to tear you down. They're not your enemy. We need to understand that. For our struggle is not with flesh and blood. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. What are demons? What are demons? Demons basically are disembodied spirits. I believe they're fallen angels. Remember over in Revelations where the Bible says that the dragon was kicked out of heaven in the third part of the heaven, or his angels went with him. I believe they're disembodied spirit or angel, or angelic host that was actually kicked out of heaven. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And so what are they doing then, since they're kicked out of heaven? They're walking to and fro in the earth, seeking whom they may devour. They're walking to and fro in the earth, seeking whom they may devour. Now, I don't mean to alarm you. I don't mean to alarm you, but there are some demons here this morning, as well as angels. There are demons here this morning. You know, sometimes, you know, they come in and they sit down and they'll try to distract your mind from what you're hearing right now. They'll sit there and they'll talk to you, and tell you, that ain't right. Don't listen to him. He don't know what he's talking about. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Anything to keep you from hearing the word of God. Why? Because they know if you grab hold to the truth, it'll set you free. Yeah. No. You know, so why do we have to deal with these spirits? Why come the Lord just don't do something about them? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Have you ever thought about that? That's a good question for question and answer. Why come the Lord just didn't do anything about the devil? If he's tired of us sinning and all this so forth, why don't we source of it and just kick the devil and cast him into the abyss and we're fine, right? Yeah, but then, listen to this, but then you don't have the opportunity of free will anymore. One of the reasons why the devil has been permitted to exist upon the earth and demons permitted to exist is because of human will. That is, in order for me to have a free will, I have to have the right to do wrong as well as right. If I have no other choice but to do good, where is my free will? Give me the opportunity to do wrong. That's the reason why spirits are still here, because of human will, to give you that right to be able to choose between good and evil. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But what if I choose evil? Then you're going to have to pay the cuff and suffer the consequences. You'll have to suffer the consequences. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. But the Lord has also done something so that it wouldn't be so bad. Leastwise, he's given us victory over the devil, over demons. Amen. Again, just like angels can't get around your human will, neither can the devil or demons. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is good, isn't he? Come on, stay with me now. I got something good for you here. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to know about your adversary. I want you to know about your enemy. Again, somebody said, what are they doing now? Yeah, walking to and fro in there. Right now, the devils and demons are regimented. They're in rank. That's the word I want you to say. Devils and demons, they're in rank. I just read that to you over in Ephesians chapter 6, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, see? Against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. They are in rank. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And certain demons outrank other demons. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And there are demons that have been assigned to your life, some of the lower class demons. They have been assigned to your life to keep you from walking in what God has ordained for you to walk in, and to keep you from making it to your destiny. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And they're getting anybody and any person or anything that would give them a place just to hinder you and stop you from walking in the fullness of what God has for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Again, they're out there battling with the angels in the host of heaven, and they're constantly trying to do us bad, but thank God for the angels that are there to protect us and watch over us and lead us in the right direction. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, you need to know this in talking about the devil and demons. That number one, they can't make you do anything. Flip Wilson coined this phrase a long time ago, the devil made me do it. How many ever heard that? That devil made me do it. Well, I'm here to tell you today, if you never heard it before, I'm sure you have because I've said it on several occasions, but if you never heard it before, the devil can't make people do anything. He can't make them. Can't make them. Thank you, Lord. If he could and he had that power, when you heard the gospel, he'd have made you reject it. Or he'd have made you kill yourself before you ever had a chance to reject it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No, the devil can't make you do anything. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, how does he get a hold of people? Every man is tempted. Hear me now. Every man or woman is tempted when they're drawn away of their own lust and enticed. All the devil do is move upon and motivate the wrong desires of your flesh. And when you want to yield to it, or you will to yield to it, then you yield to it. That's how it happens. And people go around talking about the devil made you. No, he didn't make you. And see, that because if the devil is out making mankind do what they're doing, then God would be unjust to send anybody to hell. Why? Because the devil was making us do it. Come on now. He'd be unjust to send anybody to hell. No, you have a will. And because of that will, there's responsibility. Now, let's get down to the nitty-gritty. Well, how does the devil get a hold of people and make people do things? Would you like to know that? Here we go. Right and wrong thinking. Right and wrong. Here is where the devil gets his power. Right and wrong thinking. Most folks don't give any thought to thinking. They don't think thinking is bad at all. I mean, you know, thinking is harmless, right? I mean, I can just sit there on my sofa in the privacy of my own living room and just think of whatever I want to think. I mean, we do it. Some of us are avid thinkers. Some of us, that's all we do. I'm afraid of the person that got too much time on their hands. Hello. Because, you know, what is that old saying they used to say? Mama, was that old saying that they used to say? An idle mind is what? An idle mind is the devil's workshop. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, I don't know whether you realize it or not, but your thoughts are very important. And what you think is very important. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I'm here to tell you today that all that you are, all that you have, and all that you are going through is the result of thoughts that you've had in days gone by. See, according to Proverbs, as a man do what? As a man does what? As a man do what? As he thinketh in his heart, so is he, or so he will become. You are exactly what you think you are. Let me ask you a question. What's on your mind? What do you think? Do you think you'll ever be able to get out of that slump that you're in financially? Do you think so? Do you think you'll ever be a millionaire? Come on. Who wants to be a millionaire? Do you think you'll ever overcome? Do you think you'll ever get your dream house? Josh, do you ever think you'll get your dream car? What do you think? Amen. What's on your mind? Do you think things are going to get better? Amen. Listen, whatever you think, that's exactly what you're going to become. That's exactly what you're going to have. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I like to ask folks this. What can you see yourself with? When it comes to thinking and thoughts, what can you see yourself with? Can you really actually see yourself becoming debt free? Can you really actually see yourself walking in divine health and healing? Can you see yourself walking in your authority in Christ? Come on. What do you think? Can you see yourself living in that mansion? Mm-hmm. Can you see this work right here going nationwide? What do you think? Pastor, I sure would like to think that. Well, you never will then. Because if you can't see yourself doing it, you never will do it. If you can't see yourself doing it, you never will do it. I still see myself going nationwide. I still see myself ministering over the television. I still see myself, you know, ministering books and all kinds of media and material going out. I see that. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I see myself being wealthy. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, to me, you can't see yourself any other way if you're in the Word of God. You can't see yourself any other way if you stay in the Word. Why? Because you're trying to control your thoughts. Why do we want to control our thoughts? Listen to this. Because what we think, we're going to eventually start saying. And we're going to work against the angels if we're saying the wrong thing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No, people don't understand that here is how devils and demons get a hold to people. They get a hold to people. The only way they can get a hold to people is through their thought processes. You think the wrong thing and you're open the door. Scripture says neither give place to the devil, but a lot of times even saints and believers are given place through their wrong thinking. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Think about it. That person that went out and committed suicide, it all started with one thought. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that husband that went out and committed adultery, it all started with one thought. Come on. That depression that you're in, it all started with one thought. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The reason why you're the last, the least, and the lost, it all started with one thought. If you're doing well in life, it all started with one thought. You want to become a millionaire? It'll start with one thought. Amen. Be like the little train that was going up the mountain. I think I can. I think I can. I think I can. Anybody ever heard of that? I think I can. I think I can. I think I can. And the closer it got up to the top, the little train starts saying, I know I can. I know I can. I know I can. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I don't know about you, but I think I can. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I think I can. What do you think? What's on your mind? Be careful that the devil don't run a freight. I like to say it like this. Don't run a freight train through your mind. I've had close friends totally separated from me because of wrong thoughts. Let the devil get in their mind and tell them any and everything about me, about you. Next time you see them, they are walking on all that side of the building or that side of the store or wherever. And you're going like, well, what did I do to them? Thoughts. Be careful what you, I say this with a heavy heart. Because I know someone right now that's in bondage. A loved one that's in bondage right now. Because the devil has gotten control of their mind. Gotten control of their mind. And I know it all started with one thought. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thoughts and demons. The area that we are most vulnerable to, the devil and demons, is in our mind. Thoughts. That's why scripture said, you know, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down strongholds. Why? Wait a minute. God has made available to us his mighty weapons. Why? Because he realizes this right here is the battleground. What do you think? What's on your mind? Thank you, Lord. Somebody asked the question a long time ago, you know, can the devil read your mind? I said, really? I don't believe he can. But I think the reason why he knows what's on your mind about 98% of the time is because he's putting it there 98% of the time. Listen. What do you think about me? I'm going to come down here for a minute. Mess with you. What is the devil telling you about me? Hear me. He lying. He's lying. He's lying. He's a liar. He can't tell the truth to save his life. So if he tell you, Pastor Foster don't like you, know that it's the opposite of that. I love you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No. people don't understand that. I mean, you know, but that's how the enemy gets in and divides. We're so vulnerable in the area of thought. I mean, you know, like right now, I just wish, but I'm not naive enough to believe that. But I just wish that all of you was focused on what I'm saying right now. But I know you're not, because the devil is sitting there, you know, taking you to the movies. While I'm up yet preaching, you're on your job tomorrow. Are you worried about that bill tomorrow? Are you worried about how you're going to do this? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on, focus in. Focus now. Focus, Danielson, focus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, but I learned, you know, this is how the devil comes in and get a hold to people, is by making them think the wrong thing. That's how he'll tear this church apart, is by making you think the wrong thing. That's how he'll tear it apart. If you ever get to the point to where you think that I'm wrong, you think that I'm wrong, I can never help you again. If you ever, this is so close to me. You have no idea how close this is to me. Because I've had relatives, loved ones, that got to the point to where they thought everybody was against them. And when they thought like that, it caused them to regress and withdraw from everybody. And nobody could get to them because they thought that everybody was out to get them. Nobody could reach them because they had made it up in their mind that everybody was out to get them. And that's the way the devil works. He'll get you. He'll come in and start putting thoughts in your mind to try to get you isolated from everybody else and from everything else through thoughts. Jesus said something about that over in Matthew chapter 6 when he was talking about, you know, folks worrying about what they're going to eat and what they're going to wear and what they're going to put on and how they're going to make it here and how they're going to make it there. Jesus said, listen, don't take the thought. He said, take no thought. Listen to this. Take no thought. Take no thought. We got to understand that here's how the devil is going to get control of you. He's going to constantly try to shoot thoughts in your mind, and your mind is kind of like the baggage checking area. When those thoughts come in your mind, you have a decision to make. Is this true or is it false? Is it worth thinking on? When those thoughts come into your mind, see, you don't know you don't know the thoughts he's putting in my mind towards you. Now, so I'm just going to be honest with you. You don't know the thoughts that he's trying to put in my mind towards you. Oh, none of those folks over there love you. Might as well leave them. Go on, go your way. You don't think he ever told me that? Hello. No, but the thing that keeps me steady is I know what God has said. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then again, I know he's a liar. So even when he's trying to tell me that Joe don't like you, I know he's a liar. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's the thing about it. I know, you know, I just have a love for everybody in this church, period and point blank. I do. And that's what really kind of keeps me, when the devil tried to put all these crazy thoughts in my head, you know, like, well, this person don't like you, that person don't like you, this person don't like you. Devil, you're a liar. That's my brother. That's my sister. And sure, we may have our disagreements from time to time, but I know they love me. Come on, y'all better say amen. Come on. No, here's how the devil comes in. And here's how the devil gets a hold to people, is through their thought processes. Anybody that has ever been demon possessed, and you all have saw maybe just a fraction of it here at this church because of my ministry, you know, but anybody that is demon possessed, they got that way through one thought that was left unattended in their mind. You know, like you're sitting there, you're sitting there watching television, and all of a sudden maybe say you see something in an adulterous position or thing played out on television. And then the devil sit there and start playing with your mind. You know, what would that be like with so-and-so? You know, and then before you know it, if you don't attend to that thought. Listen, thoughts may come and thoughts may go, but thoughts that's not dwelled upon or put into action will die unborn. Yes, there are devils and demons. How many times have the devil Oh God, don't raise your hand. Just think about it, because I don't want to embarrass nobody. But how many times have the devil showed you in an adulterous relationship with somebody else? And you're married. Yoo-hoo. I'm just going to look straight ahead, because I noticed nobody off in the devil has never told any of y'all that. Because he know that wouldn't work on you, so he never tell any of you that. Yeah, right. And I'm going to Mars tomorrow. No. I mean, he'll put thoughts in your head to see if he can get you. And don't fool yourself. He knows what you're vulnerable to. He knows your kryptonite. Don't fool yourself. He knows. And he'll do his best to try to, you know, the devil is a master at bringing division. This is something, hear me now, this is something that he's been trying to do in this church for the last several months, is bring division. And it all starts with thoughts. And then when the thoughts start coming, then the words start coming. Don't take the thought. Don't take the thought. If this church lives or survives, it's because if we were thinking right. If it doesn't survive, it's because we were thinking wrong. Now, let me show you how the devil get a hold of people. You know, it's all a process. It's just the process. Here's how he get a hold of people. Number one, he'll come in and he'll try to inject the thought in your mind. Try to inject that thought to see if you will accept it. You know, I know. I'm sitting there, you know, I'm thinking, you know, here comes, man, my goodness, what are we going to do? I said, what are we going to do about all these taxes? Oh, my goodness. They'll say, lie. Put down 3 and 4 dependents. You know, you can use your sister's children as a dependent. You know, hey, after all, look at how much money you gave your sister this year. So, you know, you might as well use her children as dependents. Of course, I know that never happened to anybody off in here. You wouldn't do that. You know that's wrong, right? But I'm saying, you know, it doesn't stop just because it's wrong. Listen to this. Doesn't stop him from bringing the thoughts. Doesn't stop him from bringing the thoughts. Thank you. So he's trying to get you to accept the thought. And here's the way it works. If he can get you to accept that thought, then all of a sudden you'll start playing it over in your mind. See, the thing of it is he's trying to get you to entertain it. He's trying to get you to keep it in your mind. Because if he keeps it in your mind long enough, what do you think is going to happen? It's going to go down into your heart. And once it gets in your heart, it'll control your life. So he tried to keep that on your mind. Here's the process of it. Here's the process of demon possession. Demons are constantly seeking to embody people. Demons right now, they have their widest range of expression whenever they can get into a human body. And the way they do that is by deception. They're the masters of deception. They always bring, oh, God, don't take me to deep. Oh, God, this is definitely Wednesday night teaching. I'm just going to assume this is Wednesday night, okay? There are some, hear me when I tell you this. Hear me when I tell you this. Don't let this get past you. Hear me when I tell you this. There are some thoughts by spirits that actually they are so deep that spirits are behind them. If they can ever get you to accept it, they're going to possess you. There are some thoughts you shouldn't think. Be careful that the thoughts that enter into your mind and that you give place to. Sitting there thinking, you're dealing with a deliverance preacher in a deliverance ministry. I'm telling you, I've been ministering deliverance for over 30 years. And I'm telling you how demons get a hold of people. Some of them because they gave place to wrong thoughts. Or gave place to what they thought was harmless thoughts. And they sit there every day, they thought about it. You know, my goodness, you know, just, boy, that old Billy Bob is nice looking, you know. Oh, man, that old Billy Bob. But wait a minute, you got a boyfriend. Wait a minute, you got a husband. You better leave Billy Bob alone. You better get Billy Bob out your head. And then all of a sudden, you know, oh, that's just Billy Bob. Oh, and the next thing you know, I mean, you know, there you, I mean, because see, Billy Bob is the guy that's on your job, that when you go in to work, you know, you'll sit down and you'll talk to Billy Bob, and you can share with Billy Bob stuff that you can't even share with your husband. I mean, you know, Billy Bob is so easy to talk to. Billy Bob is so easy to get along with. No, I've seen it yet here in this church. I've seen people get involved in relationships because the devil got in their mind and convinced them he's okay, she's okay. Thank you. Well, but they're not saved, but they go to church. That don't mean a hill of beans. That don't mean a hill of beans. Be careful. Be careful. Don't let the devil get in your mind like that. Gets in your mind and gets you to dwell on that thought, and you keep dwelling on Billy Bob, and the next thing you know, all of a sudden now you and Billy Bob, you know, you're holding hands, you're putting your hands all on each other and stuff like that, and you know, you're hugging too tight and too close, and before you know it, I mean, you go home and Billy Bob is all in your head. You can't even come on. I'm telling you how it works. I know this one woman that I dealt with. It was the thoughts that the devil kept placing in her mind was that you're never good enough. The reason why is because of that thing that happened to you when you was 5 years old. I mean, you know, and she thought on that, you know, from that point on, you never was good enough. Nobody would ever accept you. And I mean, over and relentless, kept that in her mind over and over again until one day she snapped. Devil got in. Found a way to get in. Trust me, he knows what you like to think on. He knows your favorite thoughts. Let me ask you, are they godly? I hope they are. Because if not, you're giving place to spirits. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. You have control of those thoughts. Are you depressed? Here's how it operates. You think on a thing long enough. Think about little old me. Nobody likes me. Nobody. I can't ever have friends. Nobody ever do this. Nobody ever does this for me. Da 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 da. And you're always thinking, woe is me. And then it gets to the point to where you start drawing back from everybody because you think everybody is against you. Oppression, regression, obsession. All of a sudden, you're obsessed with that in your thinking. Obsession. Once you get obsessed, then you get depressed. People can see it on you. Now you walk in and even though you're smiling, they can tell you're depressed. Anybody, let me throw this one out at you. Anybody up on here, don't raise your hand, but think about it. Have ever been depressed before? You got depressed because of thinking. Thinking got you depressed. Certain thing that you dwelled on over and over and over and over and over again. Now you're depressed. Well, you better get away from that, or you better get out of that. Why? Because the next step is possession. We see very little of possession here in the United States of America because there's so much light. It's hard for the devil to possess people in America, but yet still they are. But you know what? Somebody asked the question once before, question and answer, can a Christian be demon-possessed? What do you think? Can a Christian be demon-possessed? Yeah, now in first thought, and just at that question, at the surface, you wouldn't say, no, Christian can't be demon-possessed. They filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, listen to me now. In their spirits, in their hearts, they can't be possessed because the Holy Ghost is in their spirits. But demons can lodge themselves in the body and in the mind of an individual, and it doesn't matter whether they're saved or not. I cannot tell you. Matter of fact, most of the demons that I've ever cast out of people were Christians. They were Christians. Spirits had got a hold to their mind. I'm trying to keep this simple, y'all. You know, I talk about, you know, y'all hear me make mention of my testimony, the healing of my toothaches. I talk about the healing of my toothaches. You know, I cast a demon out of me. See, if we say, I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. if I say there are termites in your house, am I saying there are termites in you? No, I'm saying there are termites in the place that you live. Same way with demons. When we say a person or a Christian is demon possessed, we're not saying the demons is in them. It's in the house that they live in, this body or this mind. That day, I remember I came home from church. My mouth was throbbing. I told my wife, I'll be back. I went out and I went walking. I put my hand on the side of my face like this. And I kept saying, come out, come out, come out, you foul devil, you come out in Jesus' name. Come out, come out, get out of my body right now. Come out in Jesus' name. And that's how I got him out. Went home, wasn't a pain in my mouth. And that's how I got him out. And I found out that later, once I got rid of the pain that was in my mouth, I also got rid of the phobia. Remember I used to tell y'all how I used to be deathly afraid of thunderstorms and tornadoes? I didn't realize this until the next storm came. And when the next storm came, it's like, hey, went outside, man, the trees were blowing, the skies were black. And I'm going like, it's gone. It's gone. I'm going like, Lord, what happened? He said, the same spirit that manifested itself in your body was the same one that was tormenting you about the storms. Now, what are you going to do with that? I'm telling you, they can get a hold to Christians if they will let him. When the Lord wrote to the church and said, neither give place to the devil. You think he was talking to sinners? No, he wrote that to the church. Neither give place to the devil. See? Your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, going about seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist, steadfast in the faith. Meaning that demons can get a hold to you, Mr. and Mrs. Believer, if you give them a place. And how do we give them place? Through our thinking. Through our stinking thinking. Wrong thoughts. There are many times when I come in, I'm getting ready to close right now. There are many times when I can come in the house and I can tell if my wife has had a good day thinking. Cause some days she's in that, baby, what's wrong? Or I can come in and boy, and she's just, hey, baby, how you doing? I know she had a good day thinking. Yeah. Have you ever had one of those days where, when it seemed like Murphy's Law was in effect, anything that could go wrong did go wrong? Have you ever had one of those days? I was at the point one day to where I got to the point where I was almost about ready to say that because everything was going wrong and Endeavor had all these thoughts in my head. And I thought, as soon as I got ready to say that, I stopped myself and the Lord said, don't say that. And I said to myself, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I will not let myself say, have you ever had one of those days? Because I'm not going to give the devil no day. So I say, this is the day that the, and it amazes me. Every time I say that, it seems like the whole day turns completely around. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Why? Because I chose to think the right thought. Mr. and Mrs. Believer, whatsoever is lovely, whatsoever is just, whatsoever is of a good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Scripture tells you what to think on. So when a thought comes in your mind, you've got to examine it and make sure it's worthy of thought. If it's not, cast it out. Don't sit there and play with a thought. It is dangerous to play with a thought. You know, sometimes, you know, folks talk about, you know, man, I was thinking about you. You better watch that. That's dangerous. Don't be thinking. That's dangerous. Some of y'all, you think too much. And here is the problem. And herein lies the problem. Even in this church, we got people that just sit around with nothing to do but think. And so they start thinking about any and everybody in church. And they start thinking, Joe not right, Mickey not right, Yvonne is not right, Josh is not right, Brian is not right, Kathy is not right, Tom is not right, Sister Jennifer is definitely not right, Bob is not right. And before long, I'm going to leave that church. Come on, nobody's right. You're right. And if you ever get to the point where nobody's right, you're probably wrong. Wrong thinking. Wrong thinking. You know, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to repent. I've had some bad thoughts about you guys. Now, will you repent back to me? Come on. But see, but the thing about it is I refuse to give place to those thoughts. I believe I can work with every one of you off in here. I believe we can make this vision work. What do you think? I can't close this out unless I tell you this. You have authority over demons. God has given you the authority, and you got to do something about it. Don't ever worry about a devil. Don't ever worry about a demon. Demon can't, listen to me, they can't get control of you. They can't get control of you because you have authority. Jesus said, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, turn around and immediately delegated that authority to the church. Go ye therefore, and had raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We are far above all principalities, powers, might, and dominion, and every name that is named. God wishes and wants you to become the devil's worst nightmare. Instead of him sitting there antagonizing you in your thought life, get up and say, devil, if you don't get out of my mind right now, I am going to go in here and put my praise music on, and I'm going to dance for the next 30 minutes. I guarantee you that'll get him out. That'll get him out. Demons leave you when you worship him. Yeah. Scripture says, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Amen. When you begin to praise and worship God, God steps in on the scene because he inhabits the praises of his people. And when he steps in on the scene, how many know the devil steps out? Yeah. So no, don't you die. And then, you know, here's the way I do it. I said, devil, if you try to put thoughts in my head about a particular person, place, or thing, I guarantee you, I'm going to get just that much more closer to them. I'm going to bless them just that much more. I'm going to be their friend just that much more. Don't try to tell me, devil, who I can be friends with. Don't try to put bad thoughts in my head. Don't try to put bad thoughts in my head about my church. Amen. You're not allowed to talk about my folk and my homeboy and my home sisters. Come on. You don't get the chance to do that. Amen. What do you think? What's on your mind? Be careful with your thoughts. And here's the word of the Lord that comes to us this morning, church. Be careful with your thoughts. Be careful with your thoughts. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You can think yourself happy or you can think yourself sad. You can think yourself blessed or you can think yourself cursed. You can, whatever you think you can and will become. What do you think? Come on, stand.